Welcome here to Valhalla.
I lived, I died, and now I sleep. And in my sleep, I dream. And in my dreams, I see an end to the doom that will grip the earth once again. Find the Wolfkist. Find the Mad One. Find me. And save us all from another death.
Hold on, I'll just set this here.
Do you guys record everything we talk about?
Not everything, but you've been using the Animus so much, I thought this was a good chance to learn some things about prolonged exposure.
So I'm your guinea pig?
No, no, my guinea pigs are all dead. The Animus was too much for them to handle.
Cute.
Can I ask you about the bleeding effect? Any recent flashes? Any memories resurfacing?
Yeah, the usual things. Ghost images of Altair and Ezio a few times a day. Nothing intrusive, just brief moments. They pass quickly, almost without me noticing, like a figure in the corner of my eye, or remembering a dream from the night before. I did have one extended hallucination a few days ago. It was Ezio. He was older, around the time he left Cappadocia. He was standing on the deck of a ship, alone. And through him, I could feel an intense regret or guilt. And it felt to me like he'd had a loss of faith in himself, in the creed, like he couldn't keep it up, couldn't stay true to his ideals. And as I watched him, I thought, is this the moment he decided he was done being an assassin? It felt like it. Anyway, most of my visions have been brief, lasting just a few seconds. They're like complete memories of small moments that appear suddenly out of nowhere, fully formed. It's a strange feeling.
Okay, anything else?
I'm starting to see Connor now, too. Though I hear his voice more often than I see him. I'm sure that will change. Oh, yeah, and yesterday, just before bed, I had a memory of being on a beach in the Caribbean with a bunch of sailors. Or maybe they were pirates. I don't know. No idea.
Huh. We'll look into that. And how do you feel in general?
In general? Well, I feel older, for one. Much older. And it's strangely comforting. I'm collecting the memories and skills and thoughts of so many people. I feel like I've lived a few hundred years or more. Is it possible that if I do this for too long, it'll push my own memories aside? That I'll be everyone but myself after a while?
It's possible. That's called identity substitution. It's happened before, but it's rare. And someone with your background shouldn't need to worry.
My background? You mean someone with my genes? My abilities?
You have Isu DNA, and that lets you see things and do things and withstand traumas that other people can't.
And I can suffer in ways that others can't. That's not something to be proud of.
You mean the apple?
Yeah. It has a pull, Bex. It tugs at my brain. It talks to me, teases me, drives me mad. And what I did to Lucy, God damn it. Nothing is worth the damage I did, the pain I caused.
I know, but you're special. That's the point.
I'm not special, Bex. I'm lucky. That's all.
I understand.
We're assassins. It's our creed that makes us different, not our genes, not our blood. Anyone can join us.
That's true. But let's leave that aside for a second. What I want to know is, have you ever had any Isu memories resurface?
Isu memories? I don't think so. I can't even begin to imagine what that would feel like.
I think you'd know if you did. Maybe one day. We might be able to induce something.
Jesus, let's fix the world first, okay? Before we start digging up my ancient ancestors.
Deal.
With my luck, I'll be related to some third-rate Isu like Sisyphus or something.
Way to aim high, buddy.
Hey, you gotta.
Layla, thought you might be interested in this. Conversations that Bex and I had with Desmond back in 2012. December, I think. Just, candid talks, that's all. We didn't square any circles or write any beat poetry. But he did have some interesting insights into his time in the Animus and what it means to be an assassin. Anyway, have a listen. You might find you and he had similar experiences, so, well, let me know what you think. Unless it's to tell me I sound like a total prat in these recordings. If that's the case, just say nothing. I mean, I did have a slight cold at the time I recorded these. That's probably why I sound odd. Anyway, okay, I'm done anyway, so turn off. Turn off. Oh, it's actually just a button. Sorry, here we go.
No, come on, Sean. Turn that thing off.
Oh, hold on. I like what you said there. I want to get this for posterity. Say it again, nice and loud.
Seriously?
Sure, come on. If nothing else, it'll give me leverage with your old man.
Ah, that's your angle. Nice. What I said was, I wish I hadn't been born into the Assassins. I wish I had chosen this life. Is that good enough?
Sure, but why is that?
Because choice is the central idea of our creed. It underpins everything, right? It's about free will. It's about seeing the evidence before you and saying, yes, this is what I want. Or, no, this isn't for me. But when you're born into a group like this, or any other, like I was, you get mixed signals. You get told over and over again, this is what we believe. These are the rules. This is reality. No deviation. And if you question it, oh, they look at you like you killed a puppy. That's hardly free will. It's a weird irony when free will is your central belief, but nobody wants you to believe otherwise. I don't know how to say it exactly, but I always thought there was something self-destructive about our creed. If free will is the most important moral guidepost we have, we should be free to ignore it. To choose submission, for example. You know what I mean? Like, we should be free to side with the Templars. If it's really my choice, I could do that.
Right. It's almost self-refuting. A democracy could democratically elect a dictator or choose to get rid of democracy altogether. Within our creed is the seed of its own destruction. That's what makes it powerful, I think. And fragile.
Right, right. The more freedom you have, the more risky it is, you know? Anyway, my dad has mellowed over the years, but he was strict when we lived on the farm. He ran a tight ship. I never got the impression that I was free to choose my path forward. Our creed, our tenets, they were drilled into my head. By the time I was a teenager, I was following these rules out of a sense of duty. This was just what we did.
That happens to a lot of organizations over time. The stagnation sets in, you know? The fundamentalism.
Yeah. Following the rules becomes more important than achieving whatever goal you set out for yourself. And people start to lose sight of the reason the rules exist.
That's called deontology, or a form of it. Following a rule for its own sake and not for the consequences it has.
Yeah, but that feels backwards, doesn't it?
Well, I think so. Following a rule is the easy part. Praying, taking a sip of wine, munching on a wafer. Rituals that give comfort.
But that's just going through the motions. It makes people feel like they're doing something. When the hard work is, well, actually getting off your ass and doing something productive. I think people just want boundaries. Tight boundaries. They want to see the four walls that pen them in.
I don't disagree.
Anything outside that, anything that makes life more complex, that's scary. That's why I envy you. You chose this life. You went through that process and you decided, yes, I believe in this.
Sure. It didn't stop me from being an insufferable know-it-all as a teenager, but I see your point.
I would have loved to have been a know-it-all. I knew nothing. Not until you guys found me. Yeah. It wasn't until I met you, and Bex, and Lucy, that I knew. I knew I wanted to be an assassin.
Oh, thanks, Des. Come here. Bring it in, bud. I don't normally like touching, but I'll make an exception now.
I am not hugging you.
You sure? Because I smell very nice today.
Can you just turn that off,